How do you want to be remembered? As people gather for a service in honor of your life, what do you want them to be thinking about? Final impressions are important. A strong finish can overcome a lot of problems. You might not be proud of some things in your life, things that you wish you'd handled differently, things that you wish you could change but cannot. We can't do anything about the past. What we can do is take charge of the present and shape our future. We can make changes now, and we can finish strong. Now, no one finishes a race better than this man. He is from Jamaica, and his name is Usain Bolt. Now, he might not be the fastest man out of the blocks, but once he kicks it into gear, there is no stopping him. He just simply blows by everyone on the track and celebrates his way to another major victory. Staying close to him is a major accomplishment for the world's best sprinters. I know a man who lived his life just that way. He gave it his best every moment of every day to strive to live a life that was pleasing to God and would honor him in a way that he should. As he neared the end of his life, he could say with humble assurance that he had finished his course. We're going to read from 2 Timothy chapter 4, words of the Apostle Paul, as he looks back over his life. And in verse 7 he said, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. And in the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." Here's a man who did not take his salvation for granted. He saw every day as an opportunity to do something significant in the service of God. And he did the very best he could with his life. And as he looks back on it, he talks about finishing the course. It's possible for us to finish our life strongly and do it in a way that pleases God. In Hebrews chapter 12, we see this athletic image again as the writer describes the Christian life as something that is performed on a great turf inside a great stadium with many, many witnesses looking on. Listen to his picture that he paints for us in chapter 12 of Hebrews, verse 1. "Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." The statement refers to athletic competition. In a huge coliseum, the atmosphere is electric. People are excited. The crowd is going crazy. And that great cloud of witnesses, that great throng filling the seats of that stadium, consists of believers who have already finished their course. They served the Lord, and now they've gone to be with him, and they're looking on because they have passed the baton on to us. And now we're running the race. We're carrying that project forward and reaching people and doing the work of God. And so they're shouting encouragement to those who are now competing in the arena. The writer challenges all of us to take away every encumbrance, anything that would slow us down, anything that would keep us from being effective, to set it aside and focus on the race. The goal is not just to compete, but to win the race. And we find the apostle saying that in other places. He wants us to win. And so we need to give our very best efforts. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, we see this image once again. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and verse 24, the Bible says this: Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. They then do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. Therefore I run in such a way as not without aim. I box in such a way as not beating the air, but I discipline my body and make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself may not be disqualified. Give it your very, very best. The Apostle Paul tried to do that throughout his lifetime. What do we learn from the athlete? Well, we learn discipline. We learn determination and dedication. We learn something about teamwork and how to encourage those who are competing with us so that they can be focused and also be successful. So we try to develop this singular focus on doing the very best we can, excelling every day so that we can win. In order to do this, we must do our very best every day. Notice the words of the great late Vince Lombardi, famous football coach. He said this: the quality of a person's life is in direct proportion to their commitment to excellence, regardless of their chosen field of endeavor. Recently, a very famous professional basketball player was killed in a tragic helicopter accident. Do you know his name? His name was Kobe Bryant. Do you know what made Kobe Bryant such an amazing basketball player? It was his incredible work ethic. And those who knew him always talk about the determination, the effort that he gave. When Kobe entered high school, he got to the gym every day at 5 a.m. He would not leave the afternoon practice until 7 p.m. After the practice was over, he convinced his teammates to stay and play one-on-one games with him to 100 points. He singled out any player that could help him improve his skills and force him to challenge himself and become better. The relentless work ethic over his high school career turned him into one of the best players in the country, so that coming out of high school, he could move right into the NBA. So good, in fact, that just 6 years after he failed to score a single point in a basketball camp, he was drafted 13th overall in the NBA right out of high school. 6 years before, his dad placed him in a basketball camp and he wasn't good enough to score 1 point in the entire week. 6 years later, he's being drafted by the NBA. But his work ethic didn't stop there. He pushed himself even harder as an NBA player. He practiced by himself, sometimes even without a ball, hours before his teammates showed up to the gym. He forced himself to make 400 shots every single practice. He put himself through 4 hours of intense workouts on game days. He was great because he worked harder than anyone else. He practiced longer. Now that principle is still true in our spiritual lives today. We need to take our training seriously. We must be devoted to it. Spiritual growth does not happen by accident. There are many believers who never grow beyond the infant stages of their spiritual lives. And this was even true in the New Testament. There were many Christians who had just simply not been growing in their relationship with the Lord. And the Bible says that they needed to learn to determine more about committing themselves to growth. In Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11, listen to this. Concerning him, we have much to say, and it's hard to explain since you have become dull of hearing. Now, there were a lot of things that the Apostle Paul wanted to explain to these believers. There were a lot of things they needed to learn. But he knew they were not ready for that. They were not able to handle it. He says because they were sluggish. They were dull of hearing. They had become lazy in their spiritual life. They simply were not receptive. This word expresses a twofold deficiency. When a Christian life shows exhaustion, both in breathing in, that is hearing and receiving the word, And in breathing out, which refers to the application and demonstration of the word, the author of Hebrews refers to those readers as lazy. They're no longer ready to do the things that have to be done in order for them to excel. Verse 12, "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you have need again for someone to teach you the elementary principles of the oracles of God, and you've come to need milk and not solid food." These believers have been Christians for some time. They should have known a lot about the Word of God. They should have already been able to demonstrate these things in their lives. And yet, for some reason, they simply were not able to do so. They were on a maturity level much, much lower than they should have been. And instead of exhibiting maturity in the things of God, they needed to be reminded of even the most elementary things that they should have already known. They were limited to the milk of the Word and could not digest solid food. That should not be the norm. But unfortunately, in so many churches, it is. Spiritual maturity has very little to do with your spiritual age. A person can say, "I've been a Christian for 50 years. Well, that's great. But that doesn't necessarily mean that we are mature and demonstrating the kind of Christian life that the Lord would like for us to show. In fact, it has very little to do with how much knowledge you have about the Bible. I've had a lot of people say to me, "Oh, I know a lot about the Bible. I read the Bible all the time." Well, reading the Bible is fine. It's good. But applying the Scripture to your life and making life changes is much more important. So it's not a matter of just how much you've read, how much you know. It actually has more to do with the personal application of biblical truth. Verse 13. "For everyone who partakes only of milk is not accustomed to the word of righteousness, for he is an infant." Everyone who spends his time on the elementary things of the word is not accustomed to the word of God. This word "accustomed" means unskillful, inexperienced. The person who is skillful is the one who knows how to apply the Scripture to his life. Without this, the person remains an infant and can remain spiritually an infant for the rest of his life and never demonstrate the maturity that God wants us to develop. The word "infant" means childish, untaught, unskilled, and that simply should not be the point for a long period of time. In verse 14, "But solid food is for the mature, who because of practice have their senses trained to discern good and evil." Solid food is for the mature. These are people who practice the faith. They've been trained to discern the difference between right and wrong. It's sad when a Christian looks at a moral issue and they don't know where to turn, they don't know what to do, because the Bible gives us direction. And as we study it, we can make decisions about what is right and what is wrong. And someone who is skillful in the Scripture, someone who is solid in the Word of God, knows how to discern the difference between right and wrong. The word "practice" refers to the habit of the body or mind that is acquired by custom, practice, or use. The word for "practice" is gymnazo. It is the word from which we get our word "gymnasium." It's a place of exercise where a person works out and trains very, very stringently. It means to exercise vigorously in any way, either in the body, in the mind, or the spirit. And this is where discipline comes into play in the Christian life. Those who are mature are not lazy or apathetic. They are vigorous. They are committed to spiritual excellence. Now, Paul saw this same complacency in some of the believers in Corinth. So it was not just these people in Hebrews that we're talking about, but we're talking about in the church in Corinth. The same kind of situation existed there, where he was unable to teach them the things that they needed to know because they simply weren't ready to receive it. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1. "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual men, but as to men of flesh, as to infants in Christ. I gave you milk to drink, not solid food, for you were not yet able to receive it. Indeed, even now, you are not yet able. for you are still fleshly. For since there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not fleshly? And are you not walking like mere men? So the apostle talks about this lack of maturity, and it's demonstrated by our attitudes and behavior. When Christians demonstrate attitudes that are not Christ-like, when we demonstrate behaviors that are not appropriate, we are showing people our immaturity, our inability to process and think through the spiritual things in life and to apply those things to our lives the way we should. So maturity requires that we take these old attitudes and behaviors and see them as no longer acceptable. That's why the Bible says we're to put off the old and put on the new. That's a regular, ongoing process for a believer. We see that there are some things in our lives that are not acceptable. They don't glorify God. They don't help us or others. We need to eliminate that. There are other things that we need to add to our life and to put that into our life so that we can be more honoring to God. And that's the process of spiritual maturity, growing, learning, applying, demonstrating those things to the world. James wrote about wisdom, and he said there is a wisdom that is divisive and self-serving. But that is not the wisdom from above. It is earthly, it is human. It is very common, even in the church, but it is not from God. So many churches are racked by division, fighting within the congregation, attitudes, behaviors that really do not promote the gospel at all. And sometimes people come into churches like that and they sense all of this hostility, all of this brokenness, and they don't see Christ, and they don't feel a sense of peace, and there's nothing there that's attractive to them so that they might want to give their life to Christ as well. Our example matters. The way we live really matters, and it has an impact on other people. So I'm going back to that passage in Hebrews, and I want to go to the next chapter, Hebrews 6, and I want to show you what the writer says we should determine to do. Now keep in mind, in chapter 5, he said that we want to say things to you, but you're dull of hearing. You're not receiving it very well. Well, in chapter 6, he tells us what the solution is to this problem. Verse 1, therefore, leaving the elementary teaching about the Christ, let us press on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of instruction about washings and laying on of hands and the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. We will do what? We will determine to move on towards spiritual maturity. We're going to make a definite commitment within ourselves that the goal is to be more like Christ, that our attitudes, our behavior, our relationships should be more honoring to God. And so we're going to make a definite commitment to do that, because you don't become mature by accident, you become mature by practice. The writer encouraged the believers to make a determination to move forward on spiritual growth. That is our goal, and that's what we're planning to do as our church moves into a new ministry where we hope to develop people in their spiritual life and move them to the next level of spiritual maturity. So many have been sliding by for years, just carelessly living their life, and God is important, but we're not making any major changes in our lives. And the Bible says that we need to take it much more seriously. When Paul came to the end of the road, he said, I have fought the good fight. I have run the race. I've completed the course. Finishing strong. That's what we're talking about. It's an intentional means of making up our minds that we're going to change for the better. This is the turning point. We have limited time. We need to make the most of it. Have a strong finish, and that's how people will remember you. And let's not forget, the Bible says, keep your eyes on Jesus as you run the race. There's a lot of distractions. There's a lot of problems. There's things that can happen that can get us off course. But the Bible says, keep your focus on Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith, and he is our great example. Keep your eyes on the coach who's standing at the finish line, cheering for you to give your very best effort as you finish the race. And then that's how folks will remember you. They might say, you know what, he went through some difficult times. And there were some times when it was really hard to be around that person. But look at the way they finished. Look how their life changed in the last months, in the last years of their life. They were so determined. They were so dedicated to Christ. Their life changed. Their attitudes and relationships changed. So let's get to work and keep our eyes on the prize. So that when we finally do leave this world, we will stand before the Lord someday and hear Him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." It's important for us, folks, to make the most of our time. Some people say, well, I'm getting older. That's great. You've learned a lot in your lifetime. You've learned a lot of things that don't work, and perhaps you've found some that do. But as we really pursue our Christian life to full maturity, as we see that finish line out there becoming closer and closer to us, we know that we have been giving our very best effort to the one who gave his life for us. Let's move on to maturity. Let's pray. Lord God, you're an awesome God, and we love you and we honor you. And it is true that for so many of us, some portions of our lives have been lived rather carelessly, rather lazily when it comes to the spiritual life. And we've got to make up for that. We need to take some time to really take stock of our life and see what it is that really does honor you and the things that do not. We need to change some attitudes and some behavior. We need to work on some relationships and spend the rest of the time that we have really pursuing the goal that you have for us. We're not just to run this race, we are to run to win. And if we are winning, it's because your Spirit is living in us and the example of Christ is clearly seen in our life. That's our goal. We thank you, Lord. Give us strength. Give us your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.